Hello, welcome to Connie Martinson Talks Books. My guest today has written a book that is going to be book clubs all over America a choice read. It's called Between a Rock and a Hard Place, Why 50 is Not the New 30. My guest is Tracy Jackson, and the book is published by HarperCollins. Welcome, Tracy.
Thank you, Connie. It's great to be here.
What a funny book. And yet it is so, you know, the little needles are out. But you begin talking about growing up and how your mother in the 70s had a facelift.
She did.
And your grandmother saying, what does she need it for?
Yeah, well, you know, I started out the book doing 50 years of 50 because the book is about how 50 is not the new 30. But I wanted to look at what 50 has been and how far we've come in 50 years. So I started out looking at my grandmother at 50, who was a real grandmother and looked like a grandmother looks. And I think is still, in terms of the boomer mentality and perhaps why we've adopted and this point of view that we're actually younger than we are, is because we really didn't want to look like our grandparents. And in many ways, we don't. So I looked at who she was at 50. And at 50, you know, she was an older woman. She looked like an older woman. She dressed like an older woman. She behaved like an older woman. And she accepted being an older woman. She had no desire to be in a pair of jeans and wear a t-shirt that said Hot Mama, or, you know, she was grandma. And I think that had to do a lot with that generation, having been through two world wars, the Depression. Really, they didn't have this entitlement to, we've got to be young.
Perennial youth.
Yeah, I mean, I think they were so happy to have just made it.
And then comes your mother's generation. And suddenly, Claire Auld, does she or doesn't she? And all of the people were getting divorces. So suddenly, you had to look good because there's got to be Mr. Right around the corner. And so that generation went in for plastic surgery, and it was evidently horrible to go through. I don't know today, but horrible then. And she also followed, I loved Gaylord Houser. Okay. For those who don't remember, go back and look at old Vogue magazines. He was the nutritionist for Greta Garbo.
He was, and I think he was one of her best friends. I think he was one of the only people who actually ever saw her in her later years. But my mother, but it's what you just said is so interesting, Connie, because I never thought of the divorce situation, that was the generation that people got divorced, and why the youth, it's so fascinating. I never connected those dots. But of course that would be true. People were all of a sudden dating in their 40s and 50s, and they hadn't been in years gone by.
And they had married young. I mean, you do mention that you had a first marriage purely, you said, out of desperation. People saying, why aren't you married? Yeah. I want my picture in the New York Times on Sunday Society. Yeah.
No, it's true. And I was 30 during when I first got married. But my mother certainly was part the beginning. And my mother was really a trailblazer, I have to say, when I look back and I compare her to my friends' parents and what have you. She really was, my mother got sunscreen before sunscreen was even in this country, and which drove me crazy, because she'd be smearing this horrible
stuff. And she had a career.
She was a writer. She still is. At 82, she still works. So she was a very modern woman, and she did very modern woman things, and she, I think, was an example for me, and certainly it made an impression on this is how you age. I certainly watched her in How You Age, and then slowly the rest of the world, well, not the rest of the world, but certainly America caught up, or parts of America, and then now we have my generation, where you can walk into the shopping mall and get your face shot up with Botox. So it's come a long way.
Yeah, and also generation that didn't marry at 21. People, you know, you read the marriage wedding, nobody's 21 anymore. They are all 30, 35. So marriage is later, which maybe is why they want to think that 30 is 50, but it ain't.
You know, it's true. And when I was writing, when I started to write this, and when the whole concept first came to me of how absurd this notion really was, that you could shave 20 years off your chronological age, I remember somebody came to me and said, well, if you're 50, but you're really 30, and I'm 36, but I'm not married, then I'm really 22 and I'm not married. Yeah. And I thought, well, this is where the delusion starts to really interfere with your forward momentum. Because, yeah. No, you actually are 36 and you're not married, and if you wait until you're 42, 43, you may not have a child. So you really can't start manipulating the math just to make yourself feel better. You've got to accept age as a number, but it's also how long you've been on the planet.
And there is a problem if you are working, ageism. I mean, when you go, I knew a friend of mine who took her driver's license and put it back 10 years. I said, how did you do it? That's criminal. She did it.
No, I think ageism is it's huge. And yeah. That's, I think what's happened is, and it's part of the delusion, part of why we do this. You know, we do look younger. There's no question. And that's why I went back to my grandmother. If you look at my grandmother at 52, a normal 52-year-old today, myself at 52, we look younger, we feel better, we're healthier, we live much longer, we're vibrant much longer. But society hasn't necessarily caught up with science in that respect. So what you have is you have a whole generation of people, 79 million boomers, 10,000 people turn 50 every day. So you've never had a population this big that's this old and going to be this old for this long. And so in doing that, we want to work longer. We don't want to retire. It's 60, 62. We don't want to be kicked out. We don't want to be marginalized. We don't want to become irrelevant. I think we feel not only entitled not to age, which is probably wrong, but we want to keep going, a lot of us. And the marketplace doesn't always embrace that.
No. You get the words, you skewer old. Now, I had to go look, see what does skewer mean when I read it. Yeah.
Oh, no. And I've bumped up against that with the book. I mean, it's been really well received, and I've gotten lots of press for it. But, people don't always want to talk about being 50. A lot of people want to pretend they're not. Or, more importantly, that their audience isn't 50.
Yeah.
And the truth is, their audience is 50.
I know. This is what the networks are beginning to discover. It is a senior population, 54 and up, who are watching NCIS or whatever those shows are.
Well, you can't you cannot discount 79 million people in this country.
Yeah.
It's not that big a country. We're not China. So 79 million people is a lot of people. They buy cars. Mm-hmm. They buy washing machines. They watch television. They buy books. Yeah. We are a big demographic, and we're not going to shut up and go away. So I guess we just decided, okay, if you're not going to pay attention, we're 30.
The other part of this is when you get into mammographies and colonoscopies and also HTR.
Yep. No, I go very in-depth into that because, number one, it's an issue. It's something that crops up. You can't, I think, if you look at yourself if you're 50 and you say I'm 30, you're not going to get the proper testing. Now, we have great advancements in medicine now, much better than we had, let's say, 50 years ago when my grandmother was 50. So if you want to live long and healthy, then you do need to go get that mammogram. You do need to celebrate your 50th birthday with a colonoscopy. I interviewed my gastroenterologist the other day for something I do on my website. If everybody over 50 got a colonoscopy every 5 years, colon cancer will be reduced by 95% in this country. That's a staggering figure.
But those are the two exams. I did a show with Susan Block, the expert, the guru on breast cancer. She was having a mammography the next day, and she was nervous. She said, there isn't a woman in the world who faces that who isn't nervous, because you don't know. You are feeling fine, and you go in and...
Oh, and I write about that. I do a whole rift on the terror that we all... I mean, but the thing is, most women think they're going to die of breast cancer. If you stop any woman on the street and say, what do you think is going to take you down?
Yeah.
They will tell you breast cancer. It's a fallacy. Not that breast cancer isn't prevalent, not that breast cancer isn't...
It's
the heart. And women don't get to the cardiologist, and this is a big thing for me. I'm very vocal about it. Women don't get to the cardiologist usually until they're on a stretcher, which is a really bad situation. We will die of heart disease 10 times more than all cancers. So it's really important. And this is actually National Heart Month, but it's really important that you pay attention to those things. If you want to... What I like to say about this book is it's kind of a GPS of how to get from 50 to 80. You know, because people don't
try 90 these days.
Or 90, but because no one actually ever tells you that when you're growing up. You have a game plan from say 20 to 50.
Yeah.
But nobody really tells you, okay, so now 50 to 80, 85. What are you going to do with it? How are you going to spend those years? Yeah. Got to start by being healthy. You start by being healthy. Those years can be amazing.
In reading the book and thinking of, you know, all of these ads for retirement homes, and I realize people go there because they don't want to be invisible, as you say, happens to someone 50. They now can join AARP, and they can also be with people their own, like tribes. They now can be with their own tribal age.
Yeah, you know, I find the people who are the most vibrant, to be honest with you, don't take that route. I do an ongoing interview thing with people between, it's called 50 at 50, and I interview people between 50 and 80 about how they live their lives, and people who are really exemplary or who I admire, or who are good role models for all of us. And usually people will say, you know, I like to hang around. I like friends my own age, but I also have friends who are younger. I also have friends who are not in my demographic because they keep me on my toes.
Yeah.
They keep me thinking ahead. I think that the world's changed so quickly. And so many people will say, let's say, I don't want to get involved in technology. I don't want to learn the computer. I mean, if you want to stay relevant, you got to keep up.
Yeah.
And that's really that's your choice. It's everyone's individual choice. But people complain about being irrelevant or feeling irrelevant when they don't actually take the steps to make themselves relevant. You can do it. It's not, you don't have to disappear into the horizon.
Now, part of that, too, with this HRT, is that there have been pros and cons about. Now, you mentioned something called
bioidentical hormones.
What is that?
Well, bioidentical hormones are hormones that are identical. The regular hormones, the old-fashioned hormones, the PremPro and the study, the study that turned it all on its ear, the Women's Health Initiative study, that's the hormone they used. And that was the standard hormone that people have been taking for decades. That you take as a pill, it goes into your system and it goes through your stomach and through your liver. But that's not the way we create estrogen when we start to lose our estrogen, which is a huge thing for women. Losing their estrogen is a giant thing for women. I mean, I call it, you know, you lose the Chardonnay drip, you lose everything. It's your memory, it's the elasticity in your skin, it's your libido. It covers your sleeping, it covers a multitude of things. But bioidenticals are absorbed through the skin.
Oh, and they go into the
It can be a patch, it can be a gel, it can be a cream, it can be a mist. It can be a lot of different things. But your body absorbs it the same way that it does when it creates it naturally in your ovaries. And so it is biologically identical to what you would be what your own ovaries would be creating. Now, I don't go out there and say take it. I don't advise it. It's not my job. I'm not a doctor.
But you are funny in the book about you and your husband and when you are going through this.
Oh, yeah.
With the hot flashes,
etc. Oh, yeah. I mean, I suffered tremendously. I mean, I suffered really, really badly. And I personally, my journey, and a lot of, and the book is my journey. My journey led me to bioidenticals. Now, that's my personal journey. Mm-hmm. Many people make the choice they'd rather not do it. Some people don't have any effects at all.
The other that is riotous is your journey. You never had much time between your two marriages. But so now you are seeing, you say, keep up, instant dating on the internet. The whole idea of exposing yourself